worship Christ, the newborn King. God is with us, even now His love is here. Come and worship, worship Christ, the newborn King. God is with us, even now.
Us. It's the name that God Father gave to Jesus. He said his name should be called Emmanuel, God with us, God wanting to be with us. That's how we sang that song. We welcome you. We want you to be among us. Come, have your way with us. We come and we gather together to celebrate the message of Christmas and all the different things that we do, the gathering together, the eating and the gifts and the presents and decorations, all wonderful. But it's the message of Christmas that permeates all that, no matter what season of life we're in, no matter where we are, what we're going through, that God is with us, and that's His promise that He's given to us tonight as we gather, as we worship together, as we declare that He is here among us. If you're a guest with us tonight, we want to welcome you. Glad you joined us. If you're live streaming tonight, we welcome you from wherever you are. And this is a family service, so kids, you may hear some kids, and that's okay, Mom and Dad. You can just chill out and relax. It's all right. But if you do need a parent room, and you may, it is open, just top of the stairs to the right, out in the foyer. And please make use of that. But we're here to celebrate. Everything that we may do tomorrow or tonight, later tonight, the purpose and the meaning of it is in Jesus. He's the one that we celebrate tonight. We're going to do that through song. We're going to do it through stories. We're going to do it through the Word. And we're going to be reminded it's all about Jesus. Let's worship.
Noel, Noel. Well, hello there. Merry Christmas. It's so good to see you.
Will you tell us a story, please?
I would love to tell you a story. Actually, I've already picked one out. This story is about how a prince of heaven came to earth to rescue the world.
Oh, this is going to be good. Because if the story's about a prince, then there must mean that there's going to be knights of the round table and valiant battles with huge swords. Hurrah!
Or maybe if there's a prince, there might be a princess.
Well, actually, many people thought that a prince would come in this way. And actually, this princess, she was a poor girl from a small town. Her name was Mary. And Mary was not married, but she was going to be married to Joseph. And an angel came and spoke to her and told her that she was going to have a baby boy, and this boy would be the Son of God named Jesus. Well, Mary must have been shaking with fear because the angel said to her, Mary, don't be afraid because God has chosen you for this very special task.
But I don't understand. Why would God choose Mary?
You know, many people have asked that same question. Mary, she didn't even know how to be a mother, let alone the mother of God's son. She was young, she was poor. But I think that God saw something in Mary that mattered more than anything else.
What's that?
Faith. She believed that God's promises were good.
But what about Joseph? This couldn't have been what he was expecting either.
Ah, Joseph. At first, he was hurt, he was confused, and then an angel came and spoke to him and said, let me read this, what the angel said, right here. Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. And all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. So the angel reassured Joseph that this was God's plan and reminded Joseph that God had prophesied this throughout the generations, that the Savior of the world was going to come. So even though they had been expecting him, they didn't know how, and they didn't know when, and now, finally, the time had come.
Expected Jesus, born to save. call me to your kingdom before your lips could speak. And even as a baby, you were reaching out for me. And now you're awaiting the day of your return, where every eye will see you as heaven comes to earth again. Until the heavens open, until the trumpet sounds, your bride is getting ready, your church is singing out. Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins. Release us, let us find our rest in thee. Come, thou long expected King.
Okay, so Mary was about to have a baby. What happened next? Did they rush to a hospital?
That's where the adventure begins.
Yeah, this is where the chasing comes in. Joseph was probably racing in the car to get to the hospital in time. Don't worry, Mary. I got this. We'll be in the hospital in no time. Oh, sorry, officer. No time to stop. We're going to have a baby.
I like your imagination, but that's not quite how it happened. Mary and Joseph, they had a long journey, likely by donkey and not car. And it would have been a difficult journey for Mary. They went to Bethlehem to look for a place to stay, but that was harder than they thought.
What? How about the hospital? A nice hotel? Surely someone would at least give up the room for Mary. She was about to give birth to a prince.
Yes, but they didn't know that. And Mary and Joseph, they kept looking for a place until finally someone opened up their stable and they stayed in the hay.
You mean to tell me that Jesus was born in a barn? With cows and horses and pigs?
Yes, exactly.
Wow, I did not see that coming. But didn't God want to announce it somehow? Maybe not newspapers, but he had to have told somebody, right?
Oh, he did. Let me read that part to you. You're going to like this. There were shepherds. They were camping in the neighborhood, and they set night watches over their sheep, and suddenly God's angel stood among them, and God's glory blazed around them. They were terrified. The angel said, "Don't be afraid. I'm here to announce a great and joyful event that's meant for everybody worldwide. A Savior has been born in David's town, a Savior who is the Messiah and Master. And this is what you're supposed to look for, a baby wrapped in a blanket and lying in a manger." And at once, the angel was joined with a huge angelic choir singing God's praises. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill towards men. And as the angel choir withdrew into heaven, the shepherds talked it over. Let's go over to Bethlehem as fast as we can and see for ourselves what God has revealed to us. So they left running and found Mary and Joseph, and they found the baby lying in a manger. And they told everyone they met what the angels had said about this child, and all who heard the shepherds were amazed.
Finally, a whole host of angels singing in the sky? That's amazing.
You know what I like most?
You know what I like most about this story so far?
What's that?
God chose Mary and Joseph, and now the shepherds. It makes me feel like Jesus wasn't just born for important people.
That's a great observation. And you're right. Jesus came into the world not just for some people. Jesus came for all people.
I think wrapping paper might be the answer. I mean, just look at everyone else with their perfect bodies and immaculate style, their clean little coats and their cute little smiles. What hope have I got to ever impress? Compared to them, my life is a mess. But if I was wrapped up, then no one could see the rips and the cracks and the screw-up that's me. The paper would cover all my faults and my flaws. I'd look just the same as the others because I would be shiny, attractive, exciting. People would see me as something inviting. If you ask what I wish for this Christmas tide, here is my answer. I just want to hide. Now that it's happened, you would think I'd be cheerful. But here is the thing, I'm actually more fearful. I know it sounds weird, but now that I'm covered, I'm scared of the moment when I'm truly discovered. I know it can't last. This is not the real me. I'm dreading the moment when I'm actually seen. What will they think? What will they say? Disappointment? Disgust as they throw me away? This is it. Here we go. My heart is racing. Nowhere to hide now. What am I facing? The paper is ripped and thrown to one side. Everything's bright as the light hits my eye. But wait, what is this? Can this really be true? You're seeing me and I'm seeing you. With hands that are caring and eyes that are kind, you pick me up and love what you find? That cannot be because of my beauty. It must be because of what you will do with me. You bind up my wounds and you clean up my pores, and now I am loved, but not because I am so perfect, so clean and so great, but because you saw me and you did not hate, but loved me, restored me, you made me clean. Now this is real freedom, to be truly seen. What could be better for Christmas this year? A Prince of Peace who scatters our fear. Yes, God is the Maker, but we hide from Him. Here is our problem. It's what is called sin. It leads to a mess, so we wrap ourselves up. We fear being seen, but that doesn't stop God from coming to find us, sending His Son. He so loves this world that Jesus has come. He loves us, restores us. He makes us clean. This Christmas, find freedom. This Christmas, be seen.
Isn't it interesting, the characters that they try to fit into the Christmas story to tell it in a fresh new age year? I don't know if you're going to see this teddy bear at the manger scene, but he's definitely making his presence tonight. And I don't know how up you are on your animated films this year, but they did fit in a new pigeon named Dave. The manger scene also incorporated Bo the Donkey. Have you seen that movie? Or don't forget Deborah and Cyrus and Felix. They're the camels that are now in the manger scene. So it's not all that surprising that we come to a teddy bear being included. But did you ever think to ask a bear, how does he feel when it comes to Christmas time? What kind of emotions is he experiencing? Is he wondering if he'll be accepted or if he'll be left on the shelf and rejected? As we looked at this bear in the video scene, he thought that being wrapped up with paper is what would make his life better. He started to compare himself to the other toys on the shelf, and he said, you know what, my life is just really a mess. And so just wrap me up and cover me, because that's going to hide my tears and my rips and my imperfections. Then nobody's going to see it. And as the story went on, then the bear encountered another fear. He then was afraid of being revealed. Once he was hidden, he thought, this is the place to be. But then he thought, what about when they rip the paper off and they're going to see the real me? And that's when he started to be concerned what the outcome would look like. But wait, what could this really be true? You're looking at me, and I'm looking at you. Hands that are caring and eyes that are kind, you pick me up, and you love what you find. Where did the video writers get stories like this? I don't mean the rhyme part. I mean the story part about the loving and acceptance and care and kindness. Well, it doesn't just come from imaginative minds. It comes from God, our Creator. God is the one who first extended kindness and care to each one of us. He looked out at his creation and he loved what he saw because he was looking at every one of us. As we heard Grandpa Jack here telling some of the story, the first Christmas story, he introduced that there was a prince that came in this Christmas story, the Prince of Peace. The Prince of Peace who came to bring healing and to bring not war, but relationship. Not hatred and pain, but love and forgiveness. This peace, this prince who came full of peace, was to change the whole world. Our furry little character here was concerned that he was going to get left behind. And I think that's a feeling that many of us entertain from time to time. It's a fear that we have that we're going to be the ones who are rejected. So we try to hide ourselves. And you may say, well, yeah, that's kind of the emotional roller coaster that I ride every week that I live. Or some of you might say, Brian, it's not a week, that's a day I go up and down. When you wake up in the morning and you realize, oh my goodness, it's morning, and quickly you sail down in your emotions. Your first cup of coffee picks you up a little bit until you get to work and then you face some opposition, somebody who calls you out and puts you down, and then all of a sudden your emotions start to crash again. Or you might say, well, that's not my course of a day, that's my course of an hour. My emotions go on that kind of roller coaster. But you're not alone in that, because I think the characters of the first Christmas story, the people who God used in the very beginning, rode some of those emotional roller coaster feelings and experiences. Think of Mary. As a young teenage girl with the hopes and excitement of getting married, knowing who her husband was going to be, and then an angel shows up. An angel, that's not an everyday experience, right? And remember, the angel said, do not be terrified. Do not be afraid. So you can imagine where her emotions were going. Her heart was beating fast. And then he said, you will conceive of a child. It will be God's son. Ladies, think of where your emotions will be going. Oh, my goodness. Like Mary first said, but why? Why me? And then she said, but how is this going to be? Her emotions would have been all over the place. Joseph, when he was confronted by the angel to say, the woman you are engaged to is actually carrying God's son in her womb right now. His emotions just went to peak level as well. And he was the one who wanted to run and hide. He didn't want to be seen. He just wanted to make this all go away. Or think of the shepherds who were out in the fields when the angels and the army of the heavenly host appeared to them. Their emotions would have been racing as well. Fear, like, do we protect the sheep or do we run away? What do we do? And the angels once again said, do not be afraid. Here's what's happening in Bethlehem. Today, a Savior has been born to you, for you, and for the whole world. So picture the emotions of all these individuals going all over the place. But you know, that's something that's interesting. None of them expected the events of that night. But everyone who responded to the events and said, yes, I want to be a part of this, their lives were changed forever. For Mary, when she was saying, how is this going to be, but why me? The angel said, you are favored by God. Her life was changed forever. She knew in that moment she was blessed by God, and she began to write a song of blessing to express her praise and how her life was changing. In that moment, when Joseph said yes to God's plan, his life changed as well, and he then had the honor of taking Mary, not only as his wife, but being the one to protect and lead God's one and only son. The shepherds, their lives were changed forever. Their credit rating went from the lowest of low to the highest of high, because everything they observed was true. And as they reported it to people, the people were amazed at what they were being told by the shepherds. Their lives were changed forever. You see, all of these individuals in the first Christmas responded to God's invitation. They went from what was unexpected to being accepted into God's story. Because they said yes to God's way and to God's offer and God's invitation, their lives would never be the same again. You see, Jesus came unexpectedly, but he came with great purpose. He came in an unexpected way as a baby, but he came to point the way to God the Father in heaven. As Jesus came in this way, it was to bring life everlasting. It was to bring a different way of life for you and I, a different way to love, a different way to know what acceptance means, what forgiveness is all about. This is God's way of bringing life into the world. But as we go back to our little friend here, if we could ask him, if we could just pause for a moment and think, what would he respond if we were to ask him, so how do you feel if God wants to include you in his plan? We'd probably hear him say things like, well, I'm way too short. I'm not black enough. I'm not fair enough. My forehead's too big. My eyes are too close together. My hair is all matted down. And he would just go through lists and lists of reasons that he would disqualify himself because he's listened to the lies being spoken over him in life. But when you look at this little bear, is that what you see? That's not what you see, is it? You just see a cute little bear that you want to just cuddle up with and snuggle in under the covers, right? But you know, you and I do the exact same thing. When we're told that God wants to use us in his plan, he's got a story to write with our lives, we say, oh no, not me, because I'm not smart enough. I don't have enough gifts and abilities. I'm not pretty or handsome enough. I can't be included in God's plan because I didn't even finish high school or I never went to college. And we just keep listing and listing all the lies that keep coming our way, and we believe them when they're not true. But God looks at you and he says, I don't compare you. I don't see your flaws. I choose you because I want to write my story into your life. I want to write your story. God looks past anything humanly that would disqualify us because he unwrapped us in the very beginning of life. And he said, I've got a purpose and a plan for each one of you. And I want you to be a part of my plan of love and salvation, of forgiveness and joy, of peace on earth that will change your life forever. You see, God can see you right here and now. You're not covered in wrapping paper. You can try and hide. He still sees through all of our disguises and all of our area hiding places. And he says, I want you to be a part of my plan. And he's inviting you to walk with him every day in this way. We've heard in the story that the way he did this was to send his one and only son, Jesus, into the world. In sending Jesus the Messiah, Messiah means the anointed one, the one who is called to be Savior of the world. We read Jesus' words. In John 17, this is Jesus praying to God the Father. He says, Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. You see, Jesus knew that God so loved the world that he sent him, Jesus Christ, for everyone who would believe in him would receive everlasting life. And so that's our hope and prayer as a church, that you would know the Savior, Jesus Christ, who came to change your life forever, the Messiah that God sent for you to rewrite your story. The Messiah wants you to call you into life with him. My prayer is that you would say yes.
Long awaited, precious promise. Son of Man. Heaven's glory in a manger has come to us in Bethlehem.
After the wise men had listened to the king, they went on their way. The star they had seen before now went ahead of them, and they followed it. And finally, it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. The wise men went to the house, and there they saw the child with his mother Mary. At once, they bowed down and worshiped him, and they opened their treasures, and they gave him gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh.
If the wise men bowed down, they must have known that Jesus was the Prince of Heaven.
I think you're right. They knew that Jesus was God's son and that he had come for a special purpose.
That's the part that still confuses me. Why did Jesus come? Why did God send him?
You know what it's like to be in the dark?
Yeah, I don't like the dark.
Well, you could say that the whole world was in dark, and it was evil. And not only the world, but also our hearts. No love, no peace, no joy. There's a favorite line in my Christmas carol that says, "Son of God loves pure light." On the night that Jesus was born, it was like a glimmer of light in the darkness, like the sun coming up over the horizon. the start of a brand new day. Jesus came to be the light of the world. Jesus came to save us.
I get it. It's like the angel said, he came to bring peace on earth.
And joy. Everyone in the story who met Jesus had joy.
Yes. Jesus came to show us how much God loves us.
Loves pure light. Wow.
Grandpa, that's not the whole story.
Grandpa, that's not the whole story about Jesus, is it?
Oh, no, my dear. The night that Jesus was born, that's just the beginning of this story of life on earth. But I'll save that story for another day.
Grandpa, what is your favorite Christmas carol?
Come with me. I'll sing it for you.
Tradition here at Koinonia. When our Christmas Eve services, we direct our Christmas Eve offering to an organization that touches our local community. Now, this year, we're going a little broader, and we've chosen True North Aid as the recipient of our offering tonight. True North Aid is led by one of our own here in the house, Ken Smith. And True North Aid is a wonderful Christian organization that is bringing hope and is bringing light to First Nations, Inuit communities, vulnerable communities all across the north of our wonderful land. And as you see through the pictures, they bring through different partnerships with other organizations and through the local communities and churches like us, food and clothing and water projects and all kinds of connecting initiatives between people here of the South and people in the North. And they have wonderful stories of how hope and light is reaching some of these communities. So we are grateful that we can partner with True North Aid and Ken Smith. And tonight's offering will be directed to their ministry where most needed. And you can do so by using the envelope provided in the seat in front of you. You can do it online. You could do it at the kiosk throughout the day whenever you have opportunity. But it's a great opportunity to partner with them and see God's love, the light and the hope of the good news of the gospel to reach some of these vulnerable communities right here in our own country. Let's bow our heads and pray together. Father, we thank you that your love has come. The good news is here. Emmanuel, you are with us. And we pray, Father, that as we give out of grateful hearts and as we partner together, God, that you would use and multiply the resources that we invest tonight, that they would express your love, that they would express your incredible value for First Nations people all over our land, that they would know that you came for them as well, that you are the hope, you are the light, and that you are the way. And so we thank you that we can partner together. We thank you that we as a church can be a church for our region, for here, for Waterloo, for Canada, and for the world. And we do that with grateful hearts, Father, for sending us Jesus. Amen. God bless you as you give tonight.
Together, now and forever. Amen.
Follow Jesus because of his birth, his ministry of love, his death, his resurrection. We follow Jesus because we believe in the truth that he brings, his teachings, that his truth knows how for us to live life daily, that he directs us and he leads us. We follow him not because all of our situations are changed, but because of how he changes how we look at our situations. He looks to help us to be able to see through different eyes, the eyes of possibility, the eyes of hope, the eyes of faith, the eyes of joy, the eyes of wisdom. And that never changes when Emmanuel is among us and in us. To remember at Christmas time that it's not about everything that is right or everything that is wrong. It's about Emmanuel, God with us. God has come to dwell with us and in us, and in him, no matter what season of life, we have his presence with us. You're going to go to many different places, and you're going to be by moments by yourself, and you're going to be times with family or friends, and perhaps eating meals together, celebrating, or giving of gifts. But the message of Christmas is for us to live every day with those that we are doing life with. And I want to remind you that as we close today, some of our leaders are going to be on the front of the platform. They'll make themselves available for prayer. No matter what your need is today for prayer, we don't have to do life alone, and we don't have to try to believe alone. We can stand with one another. And if you want to know more about this Jesus, then come and talk to one of the leaders at the front. They'd love to share more with you. As we go tonight, many of us are rushing off to different family activities and celebrations. But if you don't have anywhere you're heading out to after, and you'd like to stop by the cafe, there's some refreshments that have been prepared. If you want to take advantage of that tonight and have a conversation, make that available. But just remember that Christmas is not a one-day event. The message of Christmas is something that's alive within us that we carry every day of the year. We just have the one day as a reminder that it's a message to be lived every day. God bless you. Have a great Christmas.